In this week's space startup news, Astrobotic signs launch agreement with Andøya Space. Astrobotic, the lunar rover startup, have signed a launch agreement with the Norwegian spaceport Andøya Space. This agreement allows Astrobotic to launch their Xodiac vertical takeoff and landing vehicle to fly from the spaceport, starting in 2026. Andøya is a spaceport used by ISAR Aerospace when they attempted their first launch of their Spectrum rocket earlier this year. That failed after 30 seconds crashing into the sea, but they're already working on their second launch vehicle. Astrobotic used their Xodiac vehicle to test lunar and planetary landings. It's flown well over 100 times already. This launch agreement gives European companies the opportunity of flying on this testbed to validate their own payloads, sensors or technology, to mature the technology before flight. The Xodiac vehicle crashed on its 176th flight earlier this year. The reason for the crash hasn't been explained yet. It's a fully reusable vehicle that can be flown several times a day, with Astrobotic officials saying it's perfect for European entities looking to mature their technologies. By making a flight-proven reusable rocket available to commercial and government partners, we're enabling customers to accelerate the development of space systems in a dedicated environment built for innovation, Astrobotic CEO John Thornton said in a statement. Several European space startups are also working on launching suborbital vehicles from Europe for testing technologies such as Skyrora, High Impulse, and Space Forest. Okay, on to our second news story this week. New Associate Administrator of NASA. NASA has named Amit Shastria as its new Associate Administrator, the agency's highest-ranking civil servant position. Sean Duffy, the acting NASA administrator, praised Shastria's appointment, stating, "Amit has dedicated over 20 years to NASA, advancing American leadership in space. His leadership will drive our bold vision to return to the moon during President Trump's term," unquote. Shastria has worked at NASA for over 20 years in various roles, starting off as a software engineer and spacecraft operator. Later, he became the flight director of the International Space Station. In 2021, he was assigned to the Moon to Mars Exploration Initiative, where he became the senior leader for that program. The Trump administration wants to move away from Earth sciences and focus completely on space exploration. Shastria has a great deal of knowledge and experience in NASA's human exploration programs, so he seems like a good fit for the new administration. The online sentiment was mixed, though. Some commentators were not impressed, as he is seen as a NASA lifer and establishment figure without any commercial experience or knowledge. Critics argue NASA's relevance is waning as commercial companies increasingly dominate space operations, reducing reliance on government-run programs. In a recent congressional hearing on NASA's lunar race with China, senators fixated on government assets like the Space Launch System, Orion Capsule, and Gateway Station rather than commercial alternatives. The witnesses were carefully selected to push the narrative that China landing on the moon first would be a disaster and that massive spending on SLS, Orion, and Gateway was needed. Jim Bridenstine, former NASA administrator, has criticized the selection of SpaceX's Starship as the lunar lander for NASA's Artemis program, arguing it risks allowing China to reach the moon first. "It's highly unlikely we'll land on the moon before China," he stated, pointing to Starship's need for orbital refueling as a key flaw, overlooking the fact that the Blue Origin lander will do exactly the same. NASA has prioritized sustainability in its lunar program, aiming for a permanent human presence rather than a repeat of the Apollo-era footprints and flags approach. Reusable landers enabled by refueling are central to this vision. Bridenstine seems to want another footprints and flags program, but what's the point in that? NASA already did that. As I said in my video on the space race between China and the US, it doesn't matter if China lands astronauts on the moon before NASA. China is simply copying what NASA did a long time ago. NASA is returning to the moon in a commercial and sustainable manner with the goal of establishing a permanent human presence, while the Chinese program is entirely government-run and not sustainable. Robert Zimmerman said, "You can't build a manned lunar base with a rocket and capsule that only launches at best once a year, carrying four people. Nor can you do it building a lunar space station in an orbit that makes landing on the moon more expensive and difficult," unquote. As NASA navigates this new era under Shastria's leadership, the agency faces a pivotal choice. lean on commercial innovation for a sustainable lunar future, or cling to traditional government-driven programs in a race that may no longer matter. Okay, on to our final story this week. Oklo to build a new advanced nuclear fuel recycling center. Oklo, a leader in advanced nuclear technology, is set to build a $1.68 billion advanced fuel recycling center in Tennessee, improving the US nuclear supply chain. While not directly focused on space, this facility will play a pivotal role in producing nuclear fuels and radioisotopes critical for various space applications, from powering NASA's lunar ambitions to enabling nuclear propulsion systems. Oklo has already demonstrated the production of recycled low-enriched uranium, which is likely to fuel NASA's planned 100 kilowatt nuclear power plant on the moon will use. This facility strengthens the supply chain for nuclear batteries and radioisotope thermoelectric generators, or RTGs, vital for missions to Mars and the outer planets. NASA faces a shortage of plutonium-238, the primary power source for RTGs in rovers and deep space probes. Oklo's recent acquisition of Atomic Alchemy, a company specializing in radioisotope production, positions it to address this gap. The facility could produce isotopes such as americium-241, which NASA and companies like XenoPower are exploring for next-generation commercial RTGs. Looking ahead, Oklo's recycling capabilities could support advanced space propulsion systems, including nuclear thermal propulsion and nuclear electric propulsion, although these systems often require highly enriched uranium, which Oklo does not produce. Additionally, the center's pyroprocessing can capture rare actinides, such as curium-244 and americium-241, ideal for the T-Finer system. T-Finer uses radioactive decay in thin films to generate thrust for deep space missions. By extracting these scarce isotopes, Oklo could alleviate supply constraints for this new nuclear propulsion concept. Oklo is strengthening the US-based radioisotope supply chain that benefits all companies that are working on nuclear power or propulsion. Okay, that's it for this week. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space news video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with late-breaking space news and previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.